You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good evening. I'm Bill DeLuca. Welcome to The Power of Masks. This is our very first broadcast for our Hume 310 Power of Masks class. And it's a bit unusual, perhaps, for some of the applied studies students who this class is really dedicated to perhaps understand why we have a broadcast, but maybe that'll become clearer as we go further along. But tonight we're basically going to look at the world of masks as a kind of introductory class to this topic, a topic which basically looks at how masks have been used around the world in rituals, in performances, and by you and me every day. So it has a number of different applications for sure. But here at Distance Learning, we like to think of ourselves as live and online. So feel free to join us by either calling our toll-free number. We'd love to hear from you. You see it on your screen there. 1-800-339-1193. Free from anywhere in North America, so feel free to join us. And if you want to go on the internet and type something, that could be an observation or a question, there you have our website location there, askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So feel free to use either format to create what we in theater tend to call dialogue. And that is a unique aspect of this topic of masks. It's kind of where I come from in terms of masks. But I'm curious to interact with you on this. We do like to create as much interaction in theater as possible. So here's a focus question that might be a way for you to either call in or respond with a text. Let's first look at the function of masks. Why would someone put a mask on? What would be the reason to use such a thing, right? And this is a good way for us to begin our dialogue. In fact, for those of you who are not in the Applied Studies program, one of the unique things that students have been doing all week has been writing on the basis of the chapter reading that they did about their perceptions of the ideas. And so there's been some very interesting, very well written, in fact, commentary about the use of masks. One I want to point out to you. So occasionally I'll bring in what students have written and read it here to further inform you on how relevant this topic has become, even though you wouldn't think that masks would be that entirely relevant to people. But here's what Justin Pointer said. I have been fascinated with masks. I am currently in a music group duo, and we wear masks on stage live. So this was exciting read for me in that I've never really read about the history and power of masks. So Justin, if you're out there, love to hear from you, because it's why would you want to wear a mask on stage if you're playing in a group? That's kind of a unique choice. So it ties into this whole question of what might be the function of masks? Why would someone wear a mask? So feel free to type a response in or pose a question, or maybe you want to get on the phone and call us at that toll-free number, 1-800-339-1193. So anyway, that's a lot of what we try to do, is to provoke you into dialogue with us. A little bit about me, just so that you know where I'm coming from in this class, because it's important to know, I think, that I'm not really a visual artist. I don't make masks and paint them. I'm not a dancer. I don't wear masks and perform in them. I'm not an anthropologist who studies cultures and their use of masks. In fact, I'm a stage director. My training has been to put on plays, and that's where I have made my connection with masks. But my focus is more on theater itself. I spent 10 years in New York City as an actor, director. I went on to do graduate work at Villanova and Yale. May sound impressive, I know, but quite honestly, I got into theater to help me get over my own fears of being in front of people. I thought, I'll take a couple acting classes and see if I can avoid this anxiety that I feel. And it did help. In fact, it helped so much that here I am, pretty much having a career that is over 30 years now of staging live theater. I don't do film or television. But so interesting way of getting started. But I was introduced to the use of masks while I was in college, and I always felt that there was a unique aspect to performing in masks, so much so that when I went to New York, I actually developed a workshop for actors on how to use masks just to help you become larger than life and still believable. So that became a kind of workshop I took around the country as well. So I'd always been thinking of it as an actor tool, performance tool, if you will. Then I went to a number of schools and taught, Cal State Long Beach. I was in Ohio for a while, New Hampshire, Northern California. But then I came to the south here, to Dominguez Hills. And I've been here for 25 years now. And I teach a variety of courses in theater arts, which is one of the strengths in my situation. I can teach acting classes, directing classes, playwriting classes. I teach the theater history sequence. I teach a class in the American musical. So Dominguez has been ideal for me to have a variety of experiences as a teacher and as a director. I've directed classics like Twelfth Night. I just finished a production based on Don Quixote, which was actually written by a contemporary playwright, an adaptation. But I've also done a lot of multicultural plays, contemporary works. So it's been ideal to be able to do Asian American performances like Golden Child by David Henry Hwang, August Wilson's Fences, black play about life in Pittsburgh, 1957. So Dominguez Hills has given me the chance to pursue quite a variety of experiences. And I guess I'm very indebted to Dominguez because when I came here, I saw that I needed to research the kinds of peoples that I will find in the audiences here, which is quite diverse. So I got grants to study African-American theater, Hispanic-American theater, women's theater. This also helped promote a lot more research that I did into masks. And one of the things that I found in Hispanic-American theater was the concept of a teatro, a theater that does shows specifically to help communities solve problems. So 25 years ago, I created Teatro Dominguez, and it's still going strong. We do a variety of workshops. Just recently, this last fall, we created an environmental musical for kids, and we toured it to 9 Carson schools, played to over 1,000 second graders, which featured the students actually coming up on stage and being a part of the show. So a lot of the work that we do in teatro is designed to create a formative experience for the communities. And out of teatro, one of the things that I was able to develop here is the Dominguez Bridge Theater Company, which for 5 years created plays based on interviews that they did with specific groups. So 1 year we actually did a play about breast cancer. We interviewed survivors, and that was an amazing experience for my students to go through just in that, let alone to create a play that did very well, actually. So the idea of using people's stories to create the plays that you then show that specific audience seems like a strange circle, but it's what makes theater very relevant to people's lives. Anyway, that's a little bit about me, so you know I'm coming from this as a theater person, and we will look a lot about how masks have been used in theater and performances of various kinds. Another bad news for you, though, is that I also teach speech here at Dominguez Hills. I teach how to get up and try to get over some of those fears about public speaking, and as a result, we'll talk about this later, I've incorporated 2 speeches that you need to do, and this is an online class, so how does that work? Well, a lot of students have said in the past experiences that I've done that they really appreciate being able to put together a speech without the anxiety of a whole room full of people watching. It helps them to organize the speech, which is then put onto either their laptop or somehow taped. And then we actually view it by sharing it in YouTube. So it's a very odd, perhaps, use of technology, but there are a lot of benefits to be had. And I think you'll find once you start viewing some of the other students' works that it can be very educational, very insightful. So yes, that's a challenge that I'm going to throw you in this course. Well, enough about me. I would like to find out a little bit about you as well. So I want to encourage you to do the profile that is on the Cal State Online website. It's not called a profile there, so you probably have had a little hard time finding it, but on your course homepage, you have to look for people right next to activity. And when you click on your name, it takes you into the profile that you can then fill in. So let me introduce you to some folks here. I hope you don't mind if I embarrass some of you, but Calvin, if you can show a little bit of what is on my screen, this is what it'll look like when you do your profile, and I encourage you all. Here's Sydney Burke. Hello, my name is Sydney Burke. I'm 24 years old, a full-time student, senior here at Cal State Dominguez, major in business administration with an emphasis on management and human resources. I'm also a full-time worker as an account analyst for the University of Southern California. My objective for the next 7 months is to take on another full load for summer and fall in order to be finished before 2016. Once I've completed my bachelor's program, I plan on pursuing my MBA at Azusa Pacific University or the University of Southern California. Besides working full-time and going to school full-time, I really enjoy hiking, exercising, and playing with my husky. I'm a big fan of the outdoors. I love taking road trips when I can. I also have a passion for music and DJ part-time for fun. I wish everyone good luck this semester. Go Toros! That's great, Sydney. And Sydney actually filled in a lot of information at the bottom here about education, about employment, favorite movies, different genres of music that he likes. So thank you, Sydney, for volunteering and going first. But this is exactly what I'm looking for in the profile, which I simply ask, write a paragraph about yourself and fill in a little information so that we have something to connect to. This perhaps is part of me being a theater director. We don't even know what play to do until we find out who's in the audience. I can't just do Shakespeare, and if it turns out to be a group of second graders, it's going to be a little strange. So I need to know a little bit about you before I can create something that is going to be even educational for you. So thank you, Sydney, for going first. I want to introduce you to a couple more folks here. I always love embarrassing people. But let's see, who do I have here? Waiting in the wings to make an entrance. This is always exciting to have this freedom. Let's see, here's Brooke Hooper. Brooke, when I first heard about CSUDH's extended ed program, I was elated to have the opportunity to finish my degree with the convenience of online classes. This allows me to work full-time, live in my hometown of Santa Barbara. I've decided to pursue my bachelor's degree in applied studies because I intend to become a real estate appraiser. After completion of my bachelor's, I will need to take a total of 7 appraisal courses and intern to earn 2,500 hours before I take the state board exam. I know that by completing my bachelor's degree, it will further my career and allow me to live a more financially stable lifestyle. Very nicely written, too. I mean, I appreciate what you did, Brooke, in terms of being able to tailor that. And she goes on here in terms of her job interest, in terms of her other interests. I originally studied architecture, which then morphed into interior home design emphasis that benefited my working career in furniture sales design and management. I currently work in custom upholstery sales and design consulting. Throughout my 12 years of sales and pertaining educational experience, I have developed an aptitude for customer care and always perform every task with professionalism and diligence. That's lovely. If you can talk about yourself that clearly and give the kind of detailing that brings us into a very specific understanding of a person, you're communicating and you're sharing in an open fashion. Even though this is online, I think what Brooke has just done is opened up to us. So that's why I do ask you to do a paragraph rather than a sentence. So a sentence is not a paragraph, but a paragraph is at least, what, 4 or 5 sentences? So feel free to to share this kind of information, then we know a little bit more about you. It seems to be the appropriate first step, especially for someone who's a theater guy like myself. Who else can I embarrass here? Let's see. Love doing this. Let's see. Ah, here's Gerardo. My name is Gerardo Santana, but you can call me Jerry for short. I'm a senior and will be graduating fall 2015. I'm receiving a BS in Criminal Justice Administration. I'm going through the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department process. However, I still have my mind open for different agencies such as Anaheim PD, Downey PD, even CHP. I've wanted to work in law enforcement since I was in grade school. I also plan on going back to school and getting a master's. I'm not sure in what field yet. I'm a server at Naples, an Italian restaurant in downtown Disney. If you're in the area, stop by and say hi. Huge Steelers fan, Dodgers, Kings. Just love to watch a good boxing match. Oh, you just saw one recently. I'm really into fitness as well. It stuck with me since high school, but I am glad it is a good habit I carry around with me. And then Gerardo goes on to give us some of his favorite movies. So please follow the lead here that Gerardo and Brooke and Sydney are doing, and feel free to fill out your profile. Let's see, who else do I have that I can embarrass? Well, you know, now that we actually have Mother's Day coming up, I want to see, do I have some moms here that I can talk about? Here's Damaris, and I hope I'm saying that correctly, Damaris Higuera. And Damaris, most people remember me because of my unusual name. I'm a senior attending CSUDH. My major is public administration with a concentration in health. I am also an insurance agent specializing in employee benefits. I work downtown. I assist employers in strategizing their ERISA health and welfare benefit plans and compliance with health care reform. I have two children, three dogs, so there is never a dull moment in my life. Although I have truly enjoyed the last 4 years here at CSUDH, I am looking forward to spending my evenings at home after graduation. That's great, Damaris, and have a happy Mother's Day coming up on Sunday. Sounds like you're going to have quite a circus there with the kids and the dogs at the same time. I'm trying to see also, not everyone's done their profile, so I really don't have a full accounting of this, but I know that Talina had mentioned I am a mom, a girlfriend, a daughter, sister, supervisor, and student. These are some of the masks I wear on a daily basis. Very good. I like that, Talina, that you identified that all those different roles involve a certain amount of masking. So yes, feel free to go onto your profile and fill out a little bit more about yourself. That's our important first step. And to all the moms, I'm sure it's not just Damaris and Talina. I'm sure there's some other moms out there. Have a great Mother's Day coming up. But let's talk about that focus question a little bit more. What is the function of masks? Why would someone wear a mask? I particularly want to find out what the story is with Justin and why he would want to wear a mask on stage while he's singing or playing music. And perhaps to provoke a little bit more of our inquiry, here's some images that show some of the many functions of masks. And you'll see, I'm sure you're aware just from the readings this week, that there are a wide variety of uses, and that's all these images will hopefully pinpoint for you. So there are masks that are used for disguise. For instance, a child's mask would be a great example. There's as simple as you can get a mask. You can just cut out from cardboard some holes and they serve as a new face for you. So there's a good example of a disguise. And a lot of teachers are very astute at using masks in their classes. They're so easy to make, and it's not only an art activity. Then you can have a performance. You can have your students use them as dancers, actors, performers, or whatever. So there's a lot to be gained by the actual practice of making them and using them in class. So yeah, that's an interesting disguise. We have some other ones too. In India, they have gourd masks, for instance. This is actually perhaps the original use of a mask, to put it on when you go into battle, because then if somebody hits you in the face, you've got some protection. So one of the greatest functions of masks is for protection. Makes total sense to choose something, carve out eyes so that you can see through it, but it also then gives you an alternate self, one that might be perhaps frightening to that enemy. So protection can work in a variety of ways. Certainly a gas mask would be an example of protection. These are some World War I gas masks. Unfortunately, they were quite necessary in the kind of warfare that killed millions of people on trenches in Belgium and France that were fought over for like a year's time. True insanity. But yes, gas masks for protection. I think I have an image of MacArthur wearing sunglasses. A lot of people think that we Californians must have created sunglasses. Actually, it came from World War II when, thanks to some night vision experiments that were done for flyers, sunglasses were issued to all the forces, and people came back from their experience in the South Pacific with their sunglasses. This is General MacArthur himself. So the military was very instrumental on giving us what has become a kind of unique mask that allows our eyes to be protected from the sun, and to create an alternate image of ourselves as well. Certainly when you put your sunglasses on and walk out to your car, you're a different self, aren't you? Than what you just were in your classroom, perhaps. For protection. I think I have some other children's masks here that we can look at. That's not a child's mask, that's the Lone Ranger. Very interesting story of how masks have been used for good, for law and order. Even though the history behind this story, which was a radio drama from the 1920s, 1930s, that featured a ranger who was kind of hijacked by these desperados, and he was saved and brought back to full recovery by a Native American, later known as Tonto. But they vowed revenge on these desperados. So in order to hide their identity, the Lone Ranger, the only ranger who was left in that onslaught, put on a mask. And it became a source for good, even though we also have many masks that protect criminals and provoke a lot of more nefarious activity than getting all the bad guys. So yes, it's interesting how masks have been used for both good and evil, perhaps. In fact, speaking of evil, do we have those KKK masks here, or what's next in our images of masks? Oh, there's another child's mask. You can see how easily it is to create. And we have another one there, do we? Ah, this is as nefarious as you can get in terms of protecting the wearer from being recognized for being a member of the Ku Klux Klan. Can you bring this full screen? I would love students to see the actual image here. These hoods that are worn, and at the beginning of the 20th century, realized that the Ku Klux Klan was like a corporation. I mean, you had a good 5 million paying members all across, mostly the South, but you could send away for these hoods and have them mailed. I mean, it was an amazing development in ethnic cleansing, such that it became almost totally acceptable as a business. But here you see something pretty frightening, a young boy, I guess, being initiated into the fraternity, if you will. But notice the shape of these masks. Obviously, these are hoods, and they are all white. So in terms of some symbolism, you can see that it is very much a reflection of the purpose, the function of the organization. But interesting idea to have a pointed headdress there. I don't know, maybe some of you who are watching might have an idea of why that would be there. What does that establish for them? Why aren't they just hoods that go around the head softly? Why should they come to such a point? Kind of interesting shape, isn't it? Okay, we have some other images of masks too. I think I have a torture mask. This is a terrible idea for a mask, but this is used in a 17th century prison in France to torture the person's face as it's pressed onto your face. In fact, an iron mask from France became quite famous. The Man in the Iron Mask. This is actually a famous rumor that came out of the Bastille, and a prisoner for 31 years wore, it was actually a black velvet mask, but the rumor made it that it was an iron mask. One of the inmates who came out in 1715 published the history of the Bastille and mentioned this prisoner. And there were all kinds of wonderful rumors that it was Henry XIV's illegitimate brother that was kept there. And then in the later, a century later, Alexandre Dumas wrote a wonderful novel that featured the reverse of the story, that the king was actually the illegitimate king keeping his legitimate brother imprisoned. So the French had a great time with with that story. So yes, masks provoke the imagination, that's for sure. I think we have one of Saul Steinberg, who was a famous New York cartoonist. So obviously masks have been used for amusement as well as protection, as well as disguise. If you see a lady in a veil, that does still apply in our definition. I think I have an image of a lady in a veil. Alana, can you bring that up? Yes, and in fact, a fan is a wonderful device too. Back in the 17th, 18th centuries, a woman was trained by a dance master on how to use a fan appropriately and a scarf to kind of show that she was available to perhaps someone who was watching across from the ballroom. So yes, we have some alluring functions as well. One of the unusual functions of a mask is a death mask. Now we'll talk about this much later on when we compare them to the burial masks, as you'll see next week when we go to Africa and meet King Tutankhamun, or Tut as he's affectionately known. That was a burial mask. This is a death mask, which is when a wax or a plaster cast is taken of the person who's just passed away, then you have a negative to make positives so that you can have something of a photographic memento of that person. In fact, the Romans kept death masks in their atriums. It was almost like you had the ancestors to look at on the walls there. So it was the first photograph to some extent. It was a record of that person. It served in terms of documentation very well. In fact, even in the 19th century, some of the terrible wars, they would go up to corpses, take a death mask, and then be able to use that to identify that person later. So there's been some strange functions for masks, that's for sure. And then there are theater masks, which, like this Roman mask that you'll see, this is actually stone, this is marble, so it's not a mask that someone could wear on their face, but it is a replica of what the wooden mask that were used may have looked like. And this is certainly a mask for make-believe. In other words, you are making believe that you are the king of Thebes, and your name is Oedipus, and so you can act out an entire mythological drama using masks. And there are many great plays that have used them, especially in classical times for the Greeks and the Romans. But it's interesting how modern playwrights and directors have made use of the mask as well. So Bertolt Brecht, for instance, in the early 20th century, wanted to use the mask. I think I have an image of The Good Woman of Szechuan by Bertolt Brecht. He felt that when an audience sees masks on actors, they're confused and the audience starts wondering, why are they wearing a mask? I want to just follow the story. And Brecht's point was that it made audiences think about what was going on and think about how to improve the life around them. So he wanted to break the fourth wall, as actors call it, that imaginary wall that's there between you and the performer, you and the audience and the performer, and actually have actors direct their action towards you in the audience, specifically to make you think and not let you just lull away, as we tend to do in our movie theaters, and just follow the story. So interesting contemporary use of masks as well. And there are no dramas that have gone on for four centuries and haven't changed anything of how the actors walk. So when we get to theater, we'll show you some of the unusual forms. This is a very trying form. It's almost like watching a slow motion ballet and difficult for some people to stay awake during no drama. But it has more ritual roots perhaps than performance roots. Some other masks that have been very functional in our society are masks that use makeup. The idea of dressing up and appearing a little bit perhaps more elegant than you are. I shouldn't say that's contemporary. That goes back to the ancient Egyptians, probably goes back to the cave people, right? To the original Neanderthals who wanted to adorn themselves with some of the elements from the hunt that they may have gathered. But this is an exfoliating mask, as it's called. So the idea of being able to improve your imagery by using makeup certainly qualifies as a mask. In fact, one of the students in the discussion board mentioned how Peter Marsh, who was a scholar, wrote about masking as tribal behavior. And that is something that is very, very true to how we are looking at it in this course. The idea that a collection of people share the same patterns of speech, a lot of the basic cultural characteristics, a common territory, obviously, and that for pretty much 50,000 generations, man was a hunting animal, a tribe that went looking for animals, and that was dominated by adult males. So when the agricultural revolution happened, what happens to hunting? What Marsh says is that sports began. And if you're watching whatever hockey team or the Vegas fight this last weekend, Marsh would say that we have substituted that original powerful urge that has existed in everyone with our fascination and fanaticism for sports. Soccer most especially, I would say, internationally. But a lot of today's sports heroes and their passionate followers are something of an analog to tribal hunters. So if you're curious, he wrote a book called Tribes, which elucidates this, and it's a very interesting point. And a lot of what Marsh points out also is the kind of tribal behavior that we find with masking. So if you look at a Chicana gang, for instance, this is an old photo that we have, but even though all of these girls are different in some way, they seem to share very common characteristics, especially with their makeup, the severity of their eyebrows, the expression on their face, the way that they're doing their hair. There's a kind of patterned choice there that makes them belong to their group. So we're looking at another function here that is very powerful for masks, which is social acceptance. They fit together, and it's a lot of it is how they look. They are designed in a way to fit into that image. And there are so many other cultures that can provide the same thing. So if you look at an upper class tribe, there's a woman here standing in front of a Rolls Royce. This is an individual person, but you can tell she's wearing items that qualify her to be in a certain class, whether you're talking about the poodle or the pocketbook, the wonderful pillbox hat that has a little actual mask in front of it. And there's the Rolls Royce as well. So this fits her nicely into acceptance in a rather elite group. And there's a lot of tribes, if you will, whether you're looking at Orthodox Jews, these men all seem to have the same exact kind of, can we bring up the next image here? These men all seem to have the same kind of beard, same hat, some of them have the same glasses. So there's a specific look that qualifies you as being part of a group. The Berbers in the South Sahara, they wear these lithams, which are almost ritualistic activities that they do, wrapping them around themselves. Obviously, it protects them from the sun, but it also gives them a kind of participation in the Tuareg tribe that they are a part of. So there's an interesting aspect of identity associated with tribal masking. I have an image of Guatemalan women, for instance. These are not only clothes, but they display wealth, they display status, but they're also very tribal, and they give a sense of belonging. Japanese tattoos among prisoners became a kind of an artistic revolution. I don't think we can get too close to see how beautiful these tats, we call them tats now, right? Now that they've become very, very tied into gang cultures, pop culture, I should say. But this is where it began, actually, in prison cultures going back well over a century. And some of them are quite elaborate. So yeah, this is tribal behavior that we're looking at in masking. And obviously, it doesn't have to be a mask on the face. It can be shown in the change of appearance in the body as well. And I also have one finishing image of USC versus Arizona to kind of complete that image of how sport is really a child of the traditions of our hunting ancestors. But it's amazing how much sport involves repetition, the same way that a lot of ritual activities had dealt with harvest festivals, spring rites. But the rule structures, the idea of going to a beautiful green field and in the middle of the chaos of modern life be able to watch a ball game, many find that to be a kind of reconnection with a kind of order that helps to keep our lives in balance. So very, very unique aspect in modern life of how that plays in. Most of the masks we're going to see are like this Benin bronze mask, which are used for connecting with ancestors that have gone before and can hopefully help us today. So this is a Benin mask from Nigeria. And religious divination is another very powerful function for masks that we will see quite a lot of in our analysis. Well, I want to give you another little look at a variety of masks. This is a video that we're going to look at that serves as something of an introduction, but I think you'll see quite a variety in terms of masks in here. So these are masks from many cultures.
Transform one's face and are often worn at carnivals and festivals and in processions and dances. The wearing of masks as a tradition reaches across the world and has been found in nearly all cultures as long as 30,000 years ago. Masks were not originally created to be works of art, as the Western culture often perceives them. They functioned as a transformative device, a powerful device used in rituals and ceremonies. And although masks continue to express the values of a culture, they can transform people from their everyday existence. In this parade in Mexico, masks delight as well as frighten the onlookers. In Africa, the masking tradition has been strong for centuries. A Nigerian secret society to which only males could belong and which was concerned with social order and the spirits of ancestors created this mask as a symbol of their purpose. It is made of carved wood and fiber and has a movable lower jaw. A carved wood headdress completed the costume for a dance ritual of the Yoruba tribe in Nigeria. Animals like the spotted leopard and striped tiger often appear on African tribal masks. The Puro society also made masks of wood and added raffia around the mouth. Metal caps were attached to the projected eyes. Seeds, shells, raffia, straw, those materials close to home were often used to construct African masks. Beads are often seen in Cameroon masks, and some of these are the brilliant blue of semi-precious lapis lazuli, which are intricately woven into the design. In the Sudan, masks like these were worn in dances to conjure up the spirits that bring good hunting. This Tibetan mask was meant to frighten when worn in the mystery plays performed in the Buddhist monasteries in Tibet. This contemporary mask from Bali isn't meant to be worn, but it was made as a work of art based on traditional masks that were used in ceremonial dances or in plays. The carved wood masks, usually made of ebony, are highly decorative. The appearance and function of masks from Bali show strong influences from India, the gold decorations and the bulging eyes. These quite simple painted wood masks are also Balinese. Between Polynesia and Indonesia, in the Southwest Pacific, is a region called Melanesia. This photograph, taken around 1912, shows the painted mulberry bark cloth called tapa, which is stretched over light wooden framework to construct these huge masks. Bark cloth is also used in this mask, where a flying fox is perched on top of the painted headpiece. Vegetable fiber was the material most often used for masks from the various islands of Vanuatu in the Melanesian region. On these masks, which were made around 1910, plant paste and spider webs were added to the fiber, decorated with pig's tusks, then painted in bright colors. These are the most dramatic among the Melanesian masks. The faces represented are those of the boys participating in initiation rites, who become men at this traditional ceremony. During the initiation rituals, finely carved and painted wood masks like this are placed on the ceremonial houses. The Melanesian masking tradition exists today, and masks are still used and worn in rituals and ceremonies. China, too, has a strong tradition of mask making and face painting. In ancient China, and up to the present, actors painted their faces to indicate their character in a play. Look at this completed face painting and imagine how it could also portray an evil character if the actor here wasn't smiling. In Beijing, China, this papier-mâché monkey mask was made by an artist to show the kind of makeup used in Chinese opera to represent a monkey. Another mask made of fiber was also made to represent a particular character in Chinese opera. Masks like these are made today as Chinese folk art. This child's mask is a contemporary version of an ancient tiger mask, also from China. Theatrical masks are also a tradition in Japan, and this 19th century painted and lacquered wood mask was used in the No dramas, which are considered to be the purest expression of Japan's culture. The features were somewhat natural and the coloring delicate, unlike this popular Japanese mask made today. This is a reproduction of a mask seen in Korean dances. It is made of papier-mâché. Hoods are often seen on Korean masks. The masking tradition began in Korea in the 3rd century, and they were used in ceremonies and festivals. These contemporary wood examples, which also have hoods, are made to be sold as folk art. This hooded mask represents a monkey and is worn by a child. Mexico, too, has a rich masking tradition, which continues today. These masks, hand-carved of wood...
You know, this is a great video just to show the wide variety of masks that we're now going to research. And this is basically what the chapter readings are about. We start in Africa, which will be next week, and then we're going to move on to Europe and American masks, and then finally to Asian and Pacific Islander masks. So we're going to kind of track the world of masks that way, and we're going to intersplice it with looking at some performance masks and some psychological masks as well. But this is the main look here, so in a very brief, very shortly described analysis. But that's where we're heading, to look at this very wide world of masks. We're still after the idea of why someone would wear a mask, but maybe we should ask also, what is really the power of masks? We've talked about this, we have this title here for our class, The Power of Masks. Is there really a power in wearing a mask? I guess part of that is to ask questions like, is there a power that has to do with art? Does art possess any real power, or is it just painting beautiful pictures and doing wonderful sculptures, performing an exotic, beautifully moved dance? Is there something in art that provides something that could literally be called powerful, that perhaps forces people to think a different way or act a different way? That's a lot of what my being a theater artist is all about, that art gives us a chance to really see who we are. It gives us a function of perhaps editing some of what's going on in our world so that we can be a little more cognizant of who's being left out, which has happened quite a lot, yes, who's being treated unfairly. Drama, art, painting can be used in a very powerful way. In fact, when we get to the 20th century, we'll see how political art can get, such that it can be sometimes very angry. The 1960s were famous for theater groups that almost attacked the audience and tried to drive them into action. But there is a certain power that anyone who can paint or dance or speak openly, we tend to elect them as officials in our governments. So there is some power in art. And I think you'll probably agree that there's power in religion too, because that is what we're looking at when we're seeing a shaman or a whole group of spiritual beings wearing a mask in a ceremony that is meant to kind of reconnect the whole community to some spiritual force. It's usually the ancestors in some plea for help in survival. So, I mean, religion certainly possesses a power. There are people who have battled over religion. I don't need to tell you about what strife there is in contemporary society, as well as long history of it. So yes, there is a power to religion as well. So that's what the mask is. It is a tool that artists and spiritual leaders have used in its early days. We're going to look at how it's used in performance as well. But let's come up with a definition of a mask that we can work with here, because obviously the chapter reading, as many of you in the discussion board have said, has a wide variety of definitions. You could use Timothy Tootin's example, for instance. He says, a mask is a disguise to personify spirits, gods, or ancestors, to assume social control, to educate, or to elude responsibility for one's actions. That's good. That includes the criminal intention in there. Ulrich has a very nice definition, too. In fact, I'm going to let one of our students introduce you to that. This was a very nice discussion board posting by Ernesto Bautista. And Ernesto wrote, the introduction on the power of masks begins with the question, how can wearing a mask be truthful? And that is very much the top of our first chapter reading there. At first glance, one would think that wearing a mask couldn't be truthful because intuitively, the person wearing the mask is simply hiding. Good point. But as one begins to read about the history of these masks, the many purposes, and the many insights, I at least came away thinking that there is so much to this cultural phenomenon that meets the eye. Among the myriad definitions given to masks in Chapter 1, I resonated the most with George Ulrich's, which states that masks have, quote, the ability to conceal, change, or transform the person behind the image into something or someone else, unquote. It has in the definition what I've always thought a mask to be, a tool to conceal, however, the transformative aspect particularly struck me. I found it fascinating that throughout history, there is an innate need to change or transform into something else. That's great, Ernesto, and you're very much at the heart of a lot of what motivates this course is our need for change. I mean, you really pinpointed how transformation is so central to masking. And after all, that is what a play is. In terms of my own coming at this as a stage director, we go to a play to see everything in order in the beginning, and then something goes wrong. And luckily, we have a hero who comes in, and maybe that hero doesn't go on to live at the end, but somehow they solve the problem and life is returned to order. So change is very much the center of what theater is, film, TV. We get to learn that we can change because we watch these characters who do provide some kind of change in their life, some transformation. So it breeds hope, wearing a mask as going to theater. So I'm glad you pinpointed that very clearly. In fact, Bill Song, another student, was commenting on the similar ideas here. He was, I think, perhaps reacting to Shalek's definition. Let me read Jamie Shalek's definition here for you. And this is the one that particularly suits our needs for this class. Jamie Shalek said, "A mask is any change of appearance for the purposes of protection, make-believe, social acceptance, disguise, amusement, or religious devotion," which are the functions that we were just referring to as we went through a lot of those images. But it's interesting that she says, it's a change of appearance. That's what a mask is. And doesn't necessarily imply that you have to have something on your face. It's just somehow you've changed what you look like. And that's a particularly unique way of isolating what masking is. So we're not talking about just psychological changes inside someone. We are talking about something you can see, some physical change. That's what a mask is. And it's for a variety of functions, as she brings out, protection, make-believe, social acceptance. But it is a change of appearance, and that is something we'll talk about a lot more. And Bill Song wrote this interesting discussion board today that I want to share with you too, which in a way draws credence to what Jamie Shalek was just saying. "I think a very valuable contribution in this week's reading was learning about the concept of masking, which can include changing your look to fit in with a situation. Masks can be used to change your appearance to allow for social acceptance. I chose masking as important because it is something I could really relate to. Every day when I go to work, I put on a uniform which makes me fit into the world of law enforcement and allows others to socially accept me as a member of it. In the past, I coached many teams. The uniforms I wore then allowed me to be accepted as the leader of the team and helped the members of the team to see me as their leader. Also, when I dirt bike ride, I wear special clothes and a helmet which allow me to become a dirt bike rider and to be recognized as one by other people. Masking allows me to be creative and express myself. Sometimes it even allows me to escape from the stresses of life. I am always the same person, but I am able to change the way others perceive me." Very good, Bill, and that very much is at the heart of a lot of what we're talking about in terms of what a mask can be. It can be a very transformative thing for us. In fact, I also want to just draw focus for a moment. Some of the students may be wondering, why do I ask you to write on the discussion board, first of all, a response to the reading, and then a response to somebody else's writing? And why do I ask for 100 words? I think Bill's was about 200 words, actually. I'm trying to get you to go in some depth. It's one thing to just say, boy, aren't those masks fabulous? I thought they were quite beautiful. I really love masking. But to be specific and to give us, for instance, 3 examples of masks that he wears and describe them quite vividly, that's the heart of those discussion board, I hate to say postings, because that sounds like it's a text message. They're not, they're essays. And that was an essay, just as we saw from Ernesto and Bill. Here's another one, actually. Maurilio Palma wrote a response to Pedro de la Serna on wearing a suit, how wearing a suit is masking. And Maurilio said, "Your post reminded me of a situation that happened to me when I was first hired at my current job. The first week I was there, I saw an older gentleman who wore slacks and a tie every day, including Fridays. I initially thought he was the director of my department, or at least one of the managers on the floor. After a few weeks, I was surprised to find out that he was in the same entry-level job classification as me. Funny how just dressing a certain way can make us think that one person may be something else." Maurilio, that's a great example of how in your own perceptions, you kind of fell into seeing that that image said something to you, but here he was on the same level with you. So yes, appearances can be quite telling. So that's why that Jamie Shalek definition is the one we use for the course. A change of appearance. That's at the heart of what we're going to look at in the future. So yes, what is the power of masks? It's a unique question, and what is a mask is also rather unique. I'd like to show you another small film that kind of shows a little bit of the humorous view of masking. In fact, this features, though, Roberta Markman, a famous scholar of masking who taught at Cal State Long Beach for many years, and she talks about the variety of masks worldwide. So this is a small clip on masking.
Twisted in the face was really the enigma of the face. The face is the mystery. When we look at each other, what do we really look at as what is your face and who you are? Every mask, I think, is a labyrinth. It's just carved out into a particular shape and is a metaphor for an experience. I don't think a mask can ever be considered by itself. It has to be worn by somebody who's doing something. It has to be in motion. It has to be active.
That's a great little clip from a wonderful film that was made by the Folk and Craft Museum, which for many years here in Los Angeles put on the Mask Festival. Every October, people would go to Hancock Park, and for 3 days it would feature mask makers from around the world. Literally from around the world, you could find a Balinese mask maker at these festivals. And dancers who would come in from all over the world and perform in masks. It was an extraordinary event. Didn't go into the 90s. I guess they lost funding for it, but it was quite unique. And that was made from that festival. I have another clip I'll show you in a moment. But I wanted to share with you another unique look at masking. And this is Christina Lear, and she was writing in reflection to in response to another student's post. Tamara Blake had been writing about how masks sometimes can be a way for people to get over their fears, and where we see it rather strangely in our contemporary social media is with a kind of online aggressiveness that can happen when no one's really there face to face with you. So Christina Lear responded to Tamara's post this way. I agree with you that the masks provide us with a sense of animosity that allows one to shed some level of inhibition that would normally restrict one from showing their true inner feelings. A mask can, in a way, make you someone else or someone you would like to portray. I liked how you referred to the internet as possibly being a mask. I think the cyber bullies can be a good example of that because it is like they are wearing a mask when they are behind their computer screen, bullying someone. But if they were to be placed in front of someone, they probably would not react the same with their mask off. Great post that made me think into the depth about masks. And Thank you, Christina, and thank you, Tamara, for getting her into that reflection. It's interesting to me how theater is something that is very valuable because it brings people together face to face. That is what a play is. You are not just in a dark theater watching the actors, you're very aware, because of the lighting, of who's around you. It's a community in action when you see a piece of theater. And I believe it provides more significant solutions to life than what happens when we are kind of compartmentalized or placed behind our computer screen and feel that we can say anything we want because we have this mask. So I agree with you. There is something strange about the online masking that provokes a lot of flaming comments, as we all have probably seen. I do want to just show you a little bit more of that film, because this Folk and Craft Museum is a wonderful institution. And one of the things that they used to do, they would send artists into the communities. For instance, they did one at Watts Tower here, where they had all these young boys making masks, and they were designed from African masks. So it became very much an educational experience, but it also gave these kids a chance to not only make these masks, but then be in the parade at the festival. So when you were watching the festival, you were watching the results of mask making from various neighborhoods around LA. It was a unique form of bringing people together and celebrating the arts. So anyway, this is actually the beginning of this film, which shows you some of the events that happen at this festival, the Festival of the Masks. So that's what this clip is.
Special and unique event takes place here. A recognition and celebration of the richness and diversity of ethnic heritage to be found in the city of Los Angeles. It is called the Festival of Masks, and it is a coming together of many events. Community workshops, museum exhibitions,
a parade, and climaxing it all, a two-day festival of ethnic art, drama, and dance. It is a time when people of all ages and ethnic origins gather with one another to celebrate their living traditions.
It was so fascinating. I had a number of students from Dominguez Hills go and work the parade for a number of years. It was quite an event to participate in and to see all of these dancers from all around the world. I mean, not just folklorico and Aztec dancers from Mexico, but you would see African dancers. You would see a number of peasant communities represented from Europe. Canadian dancers, Hindu dancers. It was quite extraordinary. Yeah, missed that. It was quite an event. I want to spend some time before we take our break. I usually take a break about a quarter after and take 5 minutes before we come back and do the second half. But I do want to talk a little bit about the course. I know students are kind of curious about it myself. but this is on the Cal State Online portal page. In fact, if I can show them this page for just a moment here, you probably are all familiar with it, that the course homepage is really where you can see all the various buttons that are going to lead us through. Show this should I show my screen to them for a moment here, Calvin? So here's the course homepage, and all of these are very important, so I hope you're going to have the chance to go through those. And Cal State Online likes to give you a kind of pathway through all of it. So you've got week one, week two, and links for the chapter readings and the discussion board. So I'm sure that's pretty clear to you. In terms of the syllabus, please do give it a good look in some detail here. I know that there's a lot of information here, but it is important to know that this is a general education class in the humanities, and it is meant to be a skills development class, not just a kind of anthropological look at masks. So do look through the general education objectives as well as our own power of mask description, which is basically looking at African, European, American, and Asian Pacific societies, as well as how it's used in the visual and performing arts and psychological masking in human behavior. So that's very much the heart of what we're doing. And in terms of looking at the humanities, you know, it's very important to realize that the humanities provide us with a look at what it is to be human. And that's kind of unique to it in that we're looking at history, we're looking at literature, we're looking at the arts, philosophy. All these are reflections of who we are. To some extent, they are the disciplines that provide something of a mirror into our own uniqueness. It comes out of the Renaissance, which was the time of all of this new academic learning. In fact, the Renaissance man and the Renaissance woman, which happened at the same time. The idea that you should learn a little bit about everything, that you should be a jack of all trades, so that you should be able to write poems, but you should also be able to sword fight, and you should also be able to wear armor and dance. Queen Elizabeth of England did all of that. So the idea of being, having what you would call in your general education program, the breadth requirement, that you have an extended knowledge. So that's where we kind of fit in here. And to some extent, masks provide us with a unique look at the arts, the philosophy, the performing arts, obviously, of a culture. But we're going to be looking at religion. We're going to be looking at music. Obviously, those dancers have to dance to something. So the mask becomes something of a window in which to look at cultures and see that kind of diverse series of learning units in a way. It's a great way to see the totality of it through one face. Do look through the outline for that. I have all of the textbook materials, and that's all online here, so you don't have to really buy anything unless you want to buy the copy of the play that we're going to look at. But if we can just go back to this portal page for a moment too, please be aware that in terms of textbooks, that's right here. This is all the information that you'll be reading, but everything is really on this one link here that'll take you to my website that has the chapter readings. Also, in terms of the broadcasts, that's what we're doing right now. If you don't see a broadcast, that's okay. They are not actually required. In the syllabus, it says that you're encouraged, that you are expected to watch them. But if you miss it, you can go to this link here to see the archived class. So it is encouraged that you do see the broadcast. That's something that would love for you to be able to do. In terms of the course schedule, this schedule right here is the same as you're going to see in the syllabus, and everything is there, believe me, so that's easy to follow. The course outline is designed to be a kind of journey for us through the class, and you'll notice that some of these items are numbered, so there's going to be special focus on those as well. When you do your speeches, it's worth for you to look at this link right here because it explains how you actually create your speeches and send them up to YouTube. And it identifies here that it really is helpful for you to make sure that they are unlisted when you send them up rather than private or public. So do look at all of these. Believe me, you really need to have an understanding of everything that's in this course home page. Okay, what else? I just wanted to point out the writing guidelines here. We're not going to go through these too extensively, but everything in terms of writing and speaking are in these guidelines. So here's your objectives and what we're trying to do with the class. Here's how they are graded. So you have a rubric here that you can look at ahead of time. Here's a little interest in plagiarism, although I must say the applied studies students, perhaps because they come from so much of their own world experience, are very original in their writing. I've always looked forward to it. These are the directions for the writing on the discussion board, and most of you have already done it appropriately. I do ask for 100 words just to kind of ask you to go into some depth on what you're saying. And here, we can talk about this a little bit later, but I give you two options. Oh, sorry, the micro theme here is a unique paper that you're going to write where you observe someone in your own life, not yourself, someone different from you, who changes masks. So we'll talk a little bit more about that paper because it also provides you the source for your first speech. And then this is the big paper here, your research paper. And because it's only an 8-week class, you may want to look through this so that you can ask me questions online, but I give you the chance to either choose a mask that, for instance, has been used in a ritual that you can research about how it was used for that, or you can choose a mask that is more of a creative mask, something that was used by a dancer. A film would come under this category, for instance, as we'll see when we look at V for Vendetta, a wonderful film that uses masks. So anyway, do look over these two options so you'll know what's available to you. But the bottom line are, for both of these options, we're looking at a 5 full typewritten pages. We've got at least 3 citations and at least 3 sources. And I do give you some information about your sources here. I don't mind you going to Wikipedia to get some ideas, but I'd really rather you use some of the databases in our library, like JSTOR and Project Muse, to find out works that are done by validated critics and that are peer-reviewed. And then the guidelines also include a little bit of information on your speaking assignments. So please look through this because it's such an unusual thing we're doing, asking you to tape a speech and then to send it up to YouTube for us to view, because I actually have students graded on responses that they have to your speeches. And then this is a lot of the info about your mask research speech, which is just points about giving yourself a chance to rehearse so that you'll feel more comfortable in front of the camera, and how to use good eye contact, vocal resonance, good articulation. So yes, do look over the speech guidelines for sure. That's something that will help you enormously. All right, so that basically kind of sets up a little bit of the class. It is an online class. It does have a broadcast segment. I know that that's perhaps a little unusual for some of you. Why would you have a broadcast in the first place? Most of you have taken classes that are just online classes. A lot of the work is just basically online. But I guess because the topic is masks, I always feel that it's important to put a face on what we're talking about. I tried to put a couple of your faces into this as well. And as you'll see when we do our speeches, I'm going to include you in here. The other part is perhaps my connection with theater. I am truly dedicated to the interaction that comes between an audience and the performers in a show. Actors will tell you they can sense exactly what the audience is doing, whether they're following you closely. You can even sense when an audience is encouraging you to do better. So it's not just lights down and the audience is kind of in a cave watching from a distance. There's a wonderful interaction. So I guess that's what I'm pursuing here, is to engage my audience in some way that can't be done just directly online. Is it required? No, it's not required. You're not going to get penalized. How would I penalize you for not seeing the broadcast live or even looking at the archive broadcast, right? So why watch them? What's the value of watching them? Well, the one thing that I do in the broadcast is that I pinpoint items that are going to be on the exam. So there is some good reason to watch the broadcast. You'll find out what's going to be focused on when it's time to take the exam for it. So hopefully that's some motivation for you to watch. But it seems to me as a kind of a unique offering in an online situation to provide this kind of service of creating a broadcast. Okay, I think we should take a little break here. And when we come back, I do want to go into a little more depth on masks. And we'll actually follow our outline here. We'll start at the top and talk about the same items that you've read about, the universality of masks. We'll talk about ritual. So we'll really look at a lot of what is in that chapter reading now that we've kind of laid out a little bit of what the course is about. So look forward to seeing you in the second half. We'll take a little 5-minute break now, and I hope you join me again for The Power of Masks.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
The 2015 Special Olympics World Games will be the largest sporting and humanitarian event to take place in 2015. We're very excited that LA was chosen for this event, and even more excited that the city of Carson and the university have decided to take part in the host town program.
Almost 200 million people around the world have intellectual disabilities. The late Eunice Kennedy Shriver had an incredible vision that she could change their lives through the simple power of sports and thereby transform communities around the world as they come in contact with our athletes.
And I'm even happy too that I get to see two of my close athletes, friends, and Special Olympics has totally, totally changed my life.
Mrs. Shriver's vision has resulted in more than 4.2 million athletes in 177 countries around the world, participating in about 70,000 events a year in Special Olympics.
CSUDH is very, very thrilled then to continue this long tradition by hosting a delegation of athletes and their coaches as they prepare to compete in the 2015 Special Olympics World Games. I wish to acknowledge Mayor Jim Deere and the Carson City Council for inviting CSUDH to partner with them in host town duties.
This campus is the most ethnically diverse campus in the entire system. And so the message that was just given to you about the inclusion, the diversity, it's so poignant and appropriate for Carson and Cal State University Dominguez Hills.
And it is so much more meaningful and heartwarming when we have a personal connection with them, because they'll be living with us and our students and the campus during July.
Inside the Circle of Acceptance and Inclusion, which is our primary mission. And the multicolors represent the diversity of 177 countries and the diversity of Los Angeles, and how we could reach every corner of this community with the message of acceptance and inclusion. To the mayor of the city, to the city council, and to the provost of California State University, Dominguez Hills, congratulations on being named an official host man.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
Service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi everyone, it's Bill DeLuca back at the Power of Masks for our second half of our very first broadcast. We're introducing a lot of different areas here. We've just talked about the class itself, and we've talked about the general idea of the power of masks and what is a mask. But we look forward to hearing from you, and there's our website. If you feel like typing in a comment or a question, feel free to use that askdhtvlive@gmail.com. Or you may want to be courageous and call us and make a comment on that 1-800-339-1193 number. So yeah, feel free to email us or call us. We'd love to hear from you. In fact, interesting, I wouldn't mind trying a little experiment with you. On the CSO site, I've placed a little PowerPoint that has 10 images of masks. When I do this class in a face-to-face situation, I actually have an exercise where I give everybody an image of a mask. So they may have, you know, an image that they're looking at, and I give them time to analyze the image and come up with a claim of who they think that person is without any research at all. This is basically a little critical thinking exercise, if you will. If you can imagine this face as a character, who would it be? Is it a grandfather? Is it a poet? Does it look like a policeman? Does it look like someone who's very angry? I mean, just a kind of concept of who you think that is. But then what I ask them to do is actually make a speech declaring who they think this is, and then why. And the most important part is the why, because I ask them to analyze the face and point out what is it in the face that tells you that that looks like a policeman. So it may be that they analyze how hard the eyebrows are sketched, or maybe there's a toughness to the chin, that the chin juts out and looks very aggressive. So it's based on your analysis of the features of the face as to what proves your claim. So it's easy to do that when I have students sitting in front of me in the class, but I'm curious to try it online and see if I would get any response. The way that I would want to do it is direct you first to go onto your CSO site, and if I can just show them the site here, if you were to go up to this red area here and click on document sharing, doc sharing it says. I don't know if you can see it too clearly on the screen, but when you click on this, it brings you into two pieces that I've uploaded here, but one is called broadcastmasks.ppt, meaning PowerPoint. So when you click on this, it will download for you and then you can open it. And when you open it, you're going to see 10 masks that are very different. And what I'm asking you to do is to choose one. Just one that you find fascinating. This is not a research exercise. I'm not asking you to go online and see what information you can find out as to whether it's a Mexican mask or whether it's from Africa. It really doesn't matter anything in terms of the research. What I'm asking you to do is to come up with a claim that might say, I don't know, this looks to me like a very intelligent person. I don't know why you would see that. I don't. I'm just making it up. And then in your email that you would send to us at our AskDHTV at CSUDH at Gmail, explain that. So in other words, it's not really a speech. It's more of an essay I'm asking you to write based on one of the masks that you choose. So let's see in the second half if you are interested in trying that out. Again, you don't have to go to do any research. It's just based on what you see in that face. So any of those 10 that you'll find on that document sharing site at CSO, at the Cal State Online site there. Okay, that should be interesting to track through the second half. But let's talk a little bit more about the power of masks. There's an interesting quote that I don't know if you came across it in your chapter reading, but one of the writers of the of my textbook in theater history actually wrote this, that the power of the mask is a key to a raised level of understanding, and that some anthropologists consider the ability to understand the function of the mask as key to understanding societies. This was Jack Watson and Grant McKerney who wrote this in a book that basically was on the cultural history of theater. Interesting that they should regard theater as something to do with culture. But that the power of the mask is a key to a raised level of understanding, and that some anthropologists consider an ability to understand the function of the mask as key to understanding societies. I think it's a pretty powerful thing to say, that if you understand how a mask is used, you're really understanding how a society functions. And that is something that was very much on my mind when I created this course and wanted to use masks to kind of look at culture. So interesting observation that Grant and McKerney made. But let's look at I want to give you another another video to look at here. This is also a section from that Craft and Folk Art Museum video. And this, I think, will also open up to a number of images on the wide variety that masks have been using. So this is, again, from The Power of Masks. Curious, there we go.
Tradition which continues today. These masks, hand-carved of wood and decorated with horsehair, are used in the ceremonial Pascola dances. The ancient arts of Mexico were filled with images of the jaguar, which was also called El Tigre. And today, the jaguar impersonator appears in dances in many parts of Mexico, along with representations of other animals. Unlike the other Mexican masks you have just seen, but appearing just as often in processions on religious holidays, were these masks representing the hated Spanish overlords. This elaborately carved and painted mask is worn in Bolivian ceremonial dances. Look closely to see the many human and animal images. These Guatemalan masks have been carved from wood and painted and are nearly 100 years old. A sculptor and painter known as Cayoya from the Dominican Republic made this animal mask, which is worn in carnivals. He inserted goats and pigs' teeth into the mouth and glued fur onto the head and chin. Here, you can see Cayoya as he works in his studio. Cayoya first models a mold from clay he finds at the river and allows it to dry. Then he forms papier-mâché masks over the mold, again inserting animal teeth into the mouth. When worn on the head, the jaws can be opened and closed by means of an elastic band which fits over the wearer's jaw. Some of Cayoya's masks are as enormous as they are frightening. He has added animal hair for a beard on this one. Cayoya's painting of the masks is as fascinating as his sculpture. Here, he uses fluorescent colors on the many projections. This leather and fur mask made in Alaska probably represents a spirit that a high priest or medicine man claims to have seen. An Eskimo finger mask, decorated with feathers, was held before the face in ritual dances in Alaska. You can see the finger holes in the bottom of the mask. The Indians of the Northwest Coast inhabit the shoreline from Puget Sound up to Alaska. Their life centers around an elaborate social and ceremonial structure. This face mask, made of painted wood with animal hair, was worn in a ceremonial performance. Birds and animals occurred frequently in the Kwakiutl and Nootkin myths of the Northwest Coast Indians. And an eagle mask like this one, decorated with human hair, was generally worn with a suit of feathers with large wings. A highly decorated spirit mask of wood, feathers, and quills has a raven head for a nose. The Kwakiutl transformation mask is perhaps the most dramatic of the Northwest Coast masks. This one, representing Shaman, the man who provides the community's link with the spirit world, is worn during a ceremonial dance. At the height of the dance, the music and the dancing suddenly change tempo. Then all sound stops, and the mask opens, revealing a descendant of a spirit in human form. You can see the difference between the open and closed masks here. In the reenactment of clan or tribe myths, masks like this animal mask were worn with accompanying sounds and motions. The mask has quill trim and a bladder tongue. The Iroquois of Canada made this plaited straw mask to hang outside the door of their houses for protection from evil spirits. Some Indian tribes believe that natural things of this world have a spiritual counterpart called a kachina. This Hopi dance mask is one that was made in the early 20th century and is still used today. The most familiar and popular kachinas are the wooden dolls given to children and women. Made of fabric and covered with mud, this mud head mask is worn in ceremonial dances by Hopi Indians, who also spread mud over their bodies. Called a tablita, this Hopi headdress was worn by women in butterfly dances. The face in the center is one of the Hopi representations of a spirit. This Hopi headdress was also worn by women in ceremonial dances. Eagle feathers were affixed by hide thongs to the brightly painted headdress. The Apache Indians wore headdresses like this in Gan dances. The painted wood hooves were an important element of the costume, and the dancer would use them to paw the ground. On each side of the fan-shaped piece was painted an original design decorated with hide.
It's a wonderful look that kind of sets up what we're going to do now. I thought we would go into our actual outline of the course. In fact, if you don't mind, I want to show the students the outline that we're going to follow, just because this is the place where we're going to begin the course. But you see, it begins with the definition of a mask. I don't know how well you can read this. Let me if I make it a little bit bigger. And we're going to look at universality, the types of masks, styles of masks. So this gives us a little bit of a track to follow here. We've already talked about the definition of a mask, so we pretty much set up Jamie Shalek's definition for the class. But I want to look at the universality of masks a little bit with you. And that was kind of unique in our writing and a lot of our commentary that the students made on the discussion board. What is really meant by the universality of mask? Well, it's the fact that masks developed not by one culture creating them and then kind of sharing them with another culture. Masks seem to be created by every culture around the world, at least if we define masks by our definition, which is that it's a change of appearance. So the idea that every culture has created its own masking is what makes it universal, that these unconnected cultures have all come up with this idea of masking, that it wasn't one culture who can say, we're the ones who created it. So the idea that they were created by unconnected cultures simultaneously, or at least in the same general time area in pre-scientific cultures, is rather unique. And it says something unique about masking as well. Eric Harold talked about in The World of Masks that masks are, in a way, characteristic of humanity in general, and that they do provide us with the first portraits of humanity, and to some extent, an attempt to come to grips with who we are. So it is unique how masks are universal. Are they used in every culture? Well, if you're defining masks as being wooden masks that are worn, well, there are some cultures that don't have forests nearby. If you go to the Hopi tribes in Arizona, you'll find leather masks, masks that are made with feathers. You're not going to find wooden carved masks. So I guess what I'm saying is that by our definition of a change of appearance, yes, every culture has created these kinds of rituals that involve the use of portraying characters that might be ancestors in a variety of different ways, but it always involves a change of appearance. So yes, to some extent, masks are universal. Not that everybody uses them, but that they were created separate from other cultures' knowledge of it. This may actually bring it into more focus. Talina Ornelas wrote on the universality of being human. She said, wearing masks is a timeless tradition that dates back 30,000 years. The idea of wearing masks is a simple concept that has persevered despite societal advances in education, technology, and economy. Masks can represent a society's culture and legacy. It doesn't consider other continents or traditions. It is a unique symbolic representation of humanity. That's very well put, Talina. It is a unique symbolic representation of humanity, which is why the idea of a course that focuses on masks in a way fits so nicely into the humanities area as well. So yes, the universality of masking, very central to the course, and it is obviously an item that would be ideal to include on any kind of test, right? So that's why it is numbered number one to kind of stand out as being very significant. So do bold that one on your own study guide. Classification of masks. We've already talked a lot about the different functions. Now, this course is somewhat organized by ritual masks, those that have been used in ceremonies that are designed to implore help from those who have gone before us. So there's a ritual, religious connection, function that we will look at. There are performance masks that obviously are theater masks that actors would wear, but it also extends to dancers, and we're even going to enlarge that to see how different artists have used masks. Novelists have used masks, poets, as well as sculptors. I've had students who wrote their research paper on composers who have used masking in their works, musical composers. So that is the more performance-oriented function. And we're going to look at psychological maskings, how you and I change according to the situation that we are presented with in the course of a day. And this is actually something that society demands of us. So when we get to chapter four, we're going to look at persona, Carl Jung's concept of psychological masking. And it's interesting that he chooses the word persona, which is the Latin word for mask, to identify that there are sides in us, some that have been placed there by society in what is called the collective unconscious, that are latent, ready to be used when the situation arises. So interesting psychological concept of masking. So those are the primary functions, ritual, performance, and psychological, that we'll look at in the course. Types of masks, though, that's another item on the outline here. There are a variety of types, but obviously the most common is face masks. So a mask like we're seeing in this the PowerPoint that we've just shown. Obviously, this is a face mask, if you don't mind showing. This is La Borracha, and she is a drunken woman, very, very humorous portrayal of a Mexican mask. Now, this is a face mask, so it would be attached by a string that goes around the back of the head of the performer, as would be this Balinese mask. Actually, this is across from Bali in Java. And many of these masks are face masks. This is a wonderful Iroquois mask right here that is used in an agricultural community back in Pennsylvania, New York. The Iroquois actually occupied a whole area of the northern states there. But this is a face mask. It is obviously tied again in the back. Now, many of these face masks have unusual ways of being attached. Some of them are so heavy that they have to be actually tied down to your torso as well. Some of them have tongs inside that the dancer bites down on and holds the mask in place. So some very interesting uses of masks in that respect. So face masks, we'll see the majority of them are covering the face. However, what's very unusual is how many headdresses we're going to see. In other words, a mask that extends above the head and gives the head a little bit of a superstructure, if you will. So for instance, the Ku Klux Klan masks that we were showing earlier, and we were asking, why do they extend so high to a point? Well, obviously, if you're going to stand taller than someone else, you're establishing your supremacy. In this case, white supremacy, yes. There was something about a headdress showing what a god would be like. A god would be bigger than us. Also, headdresses are unique in that they are kind of reaching up to the heavens. So it's amazing how many headdresses are used, and sometimes we're talking about a headdress that can be quite extensive. I think I have an image of the Bobo mask there that are maybe like 15, 20 feet tall. Do we have that image of the Bobo? There's a slide there of the Bobo culture that I'd like to show. If we can bring that up. Yeah, look at these wonderful masks, thank you. These are designed to be, now the dancer is below all of this raffia attachment and wearing it pretty much on their head, so they're, and it's tied down probably to their torso. But notice how tall these masks are and the wonderful kind of abstract quality in the carving and painting of them. This is actually a kind of a significant event that is like their New Year's celebration by the Bobo tribe in Burkina Faso. And what they do is they swing these masks around and help to reestablish the order that has been disrupted in the past year. So there's a very strong function to this, but the idea that it's a headdress, that it is almost kind of lifting up like a Gothic cathedral to reach up to the heavens, almost in some kind of request for help. But it's unique how many headdresses we'll see. So face masks, headdresses, and of course we're going to see a lot of helmet masks where you take a whole trunk of a tree and you carve it out so that the dancer actually can have it sitting right on their shoulders. And it also supplies some protection. So we'll see some helmet masks that are used for war as well. So yeah, the types, face masks, helmets, headdresses. We'll see many others too. There are some masks that are made just to put on as jewelry. So some unique aspects there. Also, the style of masks, this is the third item in our outline here. We're going to see an interesting variety of styles to masking worldwide. You would think, if you looked at the three different kinds of styles, I kind of outlined this in the chapter readings here, but you would think that the majority of them would be naturalistic. In other words, what is a mask but a representation of someone, so it should look like someone. Oddly enough, the least used style worldwide is naturalistic. And that takes some thought, perhaps. Why wouldn't there be masks that absolutely duplicate what a person looks like? Well, the death masks that we showed you, or did we show you? I don't know if we looked at this, but I'll give you a quick look at death masks. These are images, if I can bring up the screen here, Calvin. We talked about what a death mask is, that it basically is a plaster or wax cast that's taken of the dead person, right? So these are all death masks, and they are made to exactly duplicate what the person looks like. In other words, this is like taking a photograph of someone so that you can have them for posterity. This is going to help us to remember these folks. Here's Abe Lincoln himself. That's all painted to look like Lincoln. But many famous people have had, this is supposedly a Shakespeare image, but many poets and painters, political figures, Napoleon, this is Martin Luther, actually, famous religious figure. But obviously, the point here is that a death mask is naturalistic, and it's probably the only form of naturalistic masking we'll find worldwide, because when you are trying to portray the god, even if that god is an ancestor who has centuries back been very instrumental and has now grown into something of a mythological being, you want that god to look a little different than you and me. We don't want it to just look like an everyday face. We want it to somehow reflect what is divine. And when we, for instance, look at Tut even next week, even though there is a lot of naturalism in that image that was sculpted of that beautiful golden mask, still it is meant to be his divine state that is stylistically represented. So the majority of masks that we're going to find worldwide are expressionistic. In other words, they express something more than just the actual face of the person. So the features may be exaggerated in some way. maybe the forehead is extended to show that it knows a lot, that it has a kind of great understanding. Or maybe the nose has a kind of almost military size to it. So when there's exaggeration in the face and it certainly doesn't look like a real person, that's an expressionistic mask. And it's specifically designed to give us an image of what the divine will look like. There's another style too, which is abstract. In fact, that's what an expressionistic mask really is. It's an abstraction from a naturalistic mask. But when we say abstract, we mean it could not look like a face at all. It could look like a boat or a shield. So you have to kind of look hard to see if there's really a face there. So that's exaggeration taken to an extreme. So those three styles we will see worldwide: naturalistic, expressionistic, and abstract. Good, good. And of course, a lot of the qualities that an artist uses in working on their painting, their sculpture, are going to come in play in creating of masks. So it's a question of texture and shape and depth and line and color. And many of these masks are artistically quite powerful and also quite simple in the way that they are done. It's meant to represent a particular culture's values, so it's never too over-exaggerated in terms of embellishments. So you'll see, as we especially look at Africa, which is a great place to start because it represents the indigenous mindset in a unique way that's going to extend worldwide as we go to various cultures. Before we talk about the origins of masks, I see we have Cassandra, who has responded to one of our images on the PowerPoint. So I'm just delighted that Cassandra has joined in here. Thank you, Cassandra. And Cassandra has picked this mask here. If I can just show you, she's picked number one. I'll open it up here so you can see the full image. So that's the mask that Cassandra picked. Very good choice, Cassandra. And she's saying that, to me, in this mask, I see a very angry young woman. The way that her eyebrows are drawn together and her nose is slanted up makes me feel like she is angry. I think the reason she is angry is because she has multiple children and her face looks like they may be running amok and she would like them to stop. She looks tired yet loving. You did do that very correctly. That was very good. Thank you, Cassandra. With Mother's Day coming, I guess you saw some significance in this face for a woman who's maybe had a little too much wild activity from her kids. But I love that analogy that you made. And it is true. I mean, if you really consider just this amazing connection here of these two eyebrows coming in together. I don't think I can do this, show this any highly here, but there's something intense about the connection between these two eyebrows, and it brings into focus a kind of feeling of anger. I think you've got that right. I mean, I don't know to say that you're absolutely right. I know that this mask is actually from an agricultural tribe, and it's meant to be used at agricultural festivals, and it does represent the Bambara people very nicely. But I love how you pointed out that the eyebrows and the nose have a kind of focus that seems almost aggressive. So I think you do have an angry young woman there. And again, this is not to try to balk at the idea that there is, you know, some realistic research behind this, the actual scarification marks, we'll talk about that on the mask as well, which identifies this ancestral being, which is what is portrayed here, as part of a specific tribe, very much what we were talking about Peter Marsh saying, that masks are identity markers for a tribe, and that when not only you see them on masks, but you see them on actual faces, they are meant to say, I am part of something bigger than myself. So that was good, Cassandra. Thank you for starting us off. And I see Wendy has one as well. Thank you, Wendy. Thanks for joining us. Let's see, Wendy wants to look at number 8. I have to see what number 8 is. Oh, you picked our borracha. Can I show them again the borracha? So thank you, Wendy. The mask shown on slide 8 drew me in because of the vivid colors used to emphasize the features of the woman. It could be interpreted that the person who created the mask is highlighting beauty by paying attention to the heavy eye and cheek makeup, the lashes, and of course the lipstick. The texture of the hair is also interesting since it adds to the realistic features of the mask. At the same time, there is something that is a bit off about this face mask. For example, the woman seems to have a distant look and her expression is not jovial or sad. Very good, Wendy. I love the way you went into such detail in explaining that. And quite honestly, I tell a lot of the students in this class that it's not so much that you're coming to this class to learn about what these masks are about. You're actually coming to tell us what these masks are about. What you see in the mask is often right at the heart of what it was used for. Because after all, an artist wants to characterize something. And when this artist created La Borracha, the drunken woman, he wanted, or she, I don't actually know who made the mask, but the artist definitely wanted to create a little sense of being off, just like Wendy said. Even though you described such great detailing to the eyelashes and to the makeup, this is a woman who was very concerned with how she looked, but she's right now a little off. You caught that, and the artist would say, that's great, that's what I wanted people to get. And that's the thrill that happens in theater when the story is told clearly and the audience gets it very clearly. So what you see is, to me, the content of the course. You have to, in a way, trust your ability to draw from what you see and trust it, because often our impulses, our first impressions are very much at the heart of what an artist is trying to say in their work. So yeah, very good work on La Borracha. I like that, Wendy. Let's move on in the outline a little bit and look at some of the origins of masks. How did masks originate is a question that has fascinated and frustrated scholars for centuries. And obviously the answer is that there's no evidence to point one location, one sense of origin, as we said in the universality of masking, but it's fascinating to conjecture what may have motivated the early use of masks. We know that that masks have been used for, at least most scholars agree, for at least 30,000 years. Neanderthal man was burying his and her dead 90,000 years ago, and there was evidence of ritual activity in those funeral ceremonies. So it could go way beyond 30,000, as most are safely kind of agreeing in. The oldest mask that we have, that we know is a mask, is 9,000 years old. This is very interesting. In 1970, there was a limestone mask discovered in the Judean hills that are a little west of the Dead Sea, same place where the Dead Sea Scrolls were found at the beginning of the century. And Moshe Dayan, famous Israeli leader, actually put it into his collection, and it was there that people were fascinated by it. About 20 years later, in the 80s and 90s, there was a lot of excavations done in that area, and just this last year, there was an exhibit of these masks that went through, that came through here, through LA as well. And I just want to share this with you because I have it on the Webliography link on your site. But if you can let me show this mask. This is a very unique face. I mean, this is a little frightening, but it supposedly dates back to some of the first agricultural communities in that area. The idea of taking limestone, you would think that's much too heavy for a mask, and these holes are indications that this mask was tied to not just the actor, but it may be that dancer, actor was had some kind of headdress or some kind of covering attached to it. But now they've unearthed many of these masks, as you can see here. And they're all very different. Some of them are very sad and tragic. Some of them are almost humorous. There's quite a variety in the expressions. You may want to go on and look this up yourself, but as this museum director, James Snyder, said, these are the first glimmerings of existential reflection. And he actually talks about how strikingly similar they are to many 20th century artworks. It looks like Picasso could have made these masks. So very interesting that these are the oldest masks that we know of, that were masks, that were worn by actors 9,000 years ago. Some believe, as Olive Riley, and let me just share some of the literature on masking. Olive Riley was one of the first scholars to write about masks way back in the 1950s. And she wrote a wonderful book called Masks and Magic, in which she talks about one of the possible ways that masks originated. Masks have appeared in an infinite variety in many widely scattered primitive societies and in nearly all cultures of the world. They came into being with the first exercising of man's artistic power. The limited horizon of primitive man's world was flanked by the animals he must kill or perish himself. One cunning device for self-preservation he discovered very early was that by disguising himself in an animal head and skin, he could creep unsuspected nearer his prey. In southwestern France, on the walls of a cave known as Trois Frères, may be seen a vivid painting of the Stone Age, which apparently depicts a masked hunter or a medicine man arrayed in the horns of a stag, hairy bear's ears, and a horse's tail, presumably either to deceive the animals he is stalking or to perform a hunting dance. I think I have an image of the sorcerer. If you can jump ahead and look at the sorcerer for a minute. There he is. Now, this is from a cave in the southern section of France. This is famous as the Trois Frères, the three brothers. That's actually a reference to the brothers who found the cave and these paintings. But the drawing has been debated by scholars for centuries about whether or not this is a shaman wearing a mask in some kind of religious ceremony, or is it a mythological being that is being portrayed here? Is there an image there that's maybe it's a dream. Maybe it's just someone had a dream and put this on. But there's a lot of controversy. It supposedly goes back to 13,000 years ago. And a lot of these caves actually in the southwest of France were damaged by carbon dioxide from all of these tourists coming through. So now we have, like in the caves of Chauvet that were discovered in 1992, very much a keep out kind of attitude here. I think I have a Chauvet horse image there to show? There's some interesting naturalism. Look at this, this is a great image, thank you, of a horse drawn supposedly 17,000 years ago. And it's so vivid in terms of its naturalism. So that provokes scholars into many different fascinations about how much naturalism was actually used. But scholars have studied a lot of the rock art that shows these images and whether or not images of elephants, for instance, that were done in Tassili in Algeria when it was all green rather than desert as it is now, is a reflection of ritual activities from 9,000 years ago. There are South African rock paintings by the Bushmen that seem to be costume dancers who are doing trance dances and shamans impersonating animals. So there's a lot of evidence to play around with that scholars have dealt with. But this idea that Olive Riley is talking about is unique, that what better way to get closer to your prey but to dress up as the animal, taking a skin from the animal to be able to get closer. And that in itself, that reenactment is not only an advantage in terms of hunting, but it is a form of masking. Just as some of the earliest possible uses of masks were in warfare. The idea of going into battle with a mask on your head gives you a decided advantage. And there's many examples of gourd masks and tree trunk masks that can support that. In fact, we have the famous Zitlala warrior dance that comes from the Aztec days of Mexico. This is a great moment in Mexican life where we have two men who beat each other with hemp ropes. I mean, and these ropes draw blood, but they are wearing a jaguar helmet mask that is made of leather. It's actually very hard leather. In fact, they have to pour water on it to be able to get your head into it. So your head is not hurt, but you draw blood on the body. And it's interesting that the jaguar images that they use are a reflection of the jaguar knights from Aztec times. So it's interesting that this battle slash ritual still goes on, but it shows a lot of the long established impulses to do ritual battle, to use warfare, use masks in warfare. So yeah, the Zitlala, we'll get to that in Mexico as well. So hunting, reenactments, and warfare, a lot of possible uses for the origins of where it came from. I want to show you another little section of this film here, which also hints at some of the ideas of the origins of masks. So we have a little clip of this video on the history and origins of ritual and masks.
There is a mystic relationship between man and mask. Although created by humans, it's always seemed as though the mask itself had a separate, independent power. The mask, the powerful tool of identity transformation, is one of the most ancient aspects of human culture. The fact that the idea of making masks was given expression by mankind in many places of the world independently shows that the use of masks is a characteristic need of humanity in general. Cave walls from prehistoric times show images of humans wearing masks, indicating that masks have been used for more than 30,000 years on all six continents. The oldest surviving mask, in the sense of a second face that we know about, originated in present-day Palestine. The age of the mask, which is made of hard limestone, is estimated at approximately 9,000 years. Since prehistoric times, masks and art have been closely connected to each other. Representing a human or an animal face, mask was treated as a sacred symbolic object. The motivation for making and using masks has varied in different times and in different cultures. The original reason of using masks was to protect its wearer against supernatural beings by changing his vulnerable human identity. Such situations arose at childbirth, illness, the death of a man or a totemistic animal, the initiation of a young man into the secrets of life, the preparation of the hunt, and at the sowing or harvesting of crops. The ritual mask was an inevitable part of the rites. Man credited the mask with a supernatural power and believed that this power is existing as a result of the hidden presence of certain spirits. This explains why the masks were looked after with high regard and ritualized care, and why various taboos surrounded their making and usage. This ritualized care and mysterious attraction is still there, even after, in some areas of the world, masks have long ceased to be a requisite of magic ritual and has begun to serve the dramatic art. Although dramatic art also originates from the ancient rituals, it turned later into providing entertainment, especially in societies of the Euro-Asian continent. The mask entered a new phase of its development. In ancient Greece, masks were used in tragedies, comedies, and in satirical plays. Sophocles and Euripides wrote elaborate plays in which several characters could be impersonated by one actor changing masks. In the second century, Exaggerated masks made of cork and wood are said to have used a megaphone-like mouthpiece inside for vocal delivery in vast auditoriums. In Rome, as in Greece, theatrical masks were a necessary part of seasonal and religious ceremonies. Masks were first used in Chinese opera in the 7th century. The masks were later replaced by elaborated face painting, keeping the same rules as the original mask. Different characteristics were represented by particular colors. Loyalty by red, betrayal by white, supernatural power by gold and silver. In Bali, mask and dance dramas are almost as indispensable a part of a sacrificial ritual as the offering itself. A traditional performing mask in Bali is not just a piece of costuming. It is, in a very real sense, alive. The Balinese do not draw a line between natural and supernatural, secular and religious. Objects, particularly objects used in performance of sacred dance and theatre, such as masks, are said to be charged with a kind of spiritual magic. Some masks are so powerful that only those performers with great internal power themselves dare use them. The theatre of Rome was suppressed by the Catholic Church by the end of the 6th century, and medieval mystery plays were followed by morality plays, a mixture of farce, ritual, satire, acrobatics, music, mime and mask. This form of theatre has survived in part since the Middle Ages, but mutated to masked carnivals and folklore traditions. Even today, mask is part of the folklore traditions in many parts of the world.
I'm glad he talked so much about how theater masks, which we'll get to, came out of ritual masks. And when you watch a Balinese performance, for instance, it's hard to say whether you're really watching a drama or some kind of sacred rite. And of course, in our Western style theater, we don't see those connections anymore, although actors will talk to you about how what they feel that they're doing up there is connecting in almost a very spiritual way with an audience. But those connections are unique. But let's go back to ritual, first of all, because we have to define a ritual. What is a ritual? What elements do you need for a ritual ceremony? This is one of our last items, numbered items on our outline. And realize that a ritual is a group action. It requires a community. In fact, the original definition of a ritual is a community dancing, not just some watching and some dancing, but everyone dances. It's done in a sacred setting. It's obviously using masks to allow that transformation to happen. And along with the mask goes a costume. And there are patterned gestures and movements, even sacred words that are used. You don't speak with normal everyday language in ritual. You are asking for some kind of spiritual help. So it's natural that all of the elements should be exaggerated to some extent. And there are many rituals that we still participate in. Some of you are probably going to the graduation ceremony on Friday morning. Congratulations on your graduation. But why are there so many activities that are kind of patterned and repetitious in something like a graduation ceremony? Why is everyone in a certain kind of costume? And there are kinds of sacred words and very definite types of music. So the graduation ceremony is a very good example of a ritual that allows people to move from one stage of their life to another. So you're participating in a ritual, hopefully Friday morning. I understand we have a caller. Who do we have on the phone here?
Esther DeLuca.
Hi, Brooke. Thank you for calling. All the way from Santa Barbara. Fantastic.
Yeah. I just wanted to comment on the PowerPoint.
Good. Oh, good. Which one did you choose?
I chose number 10.
Number 10. And that's, just so that everybody will know, is this one. Calvin, can you bring it up just so that we can know what Brooke is going to talk about? Great. So, Brooke, who is this? Who is this face?
Well, I just thought it was really dynamic and dimensional, and that it almost made me feel its emotion through its expression. Through it almost has, you know, like carved in expression lines in its face. It looks almost like it's carved out of wood. And maybe used in like a theatrical performance. I don't know. It just seemed like really compelling. Like it told its own story.
It does tell a story. It's actually from a Kagura dance, which is like the no drama that we'll get to when we go to Japan. But you're absolutely right. This is such an extraordinary mask for the way that is carved to show that not just wrinkles, but there's a deep sadness in the face there. And I love how you pointed out the emotion there. You know, we go to theater, I think, to be moved. I think that is the thing that connects us so strongly to some of the films and some of the shows that we love. And that is a face that is very much bound up with a lot of emotion. So I thought you were right on with that.
I agree.
Well, thank you so much for calling. This is great to that you picked up the phone and wanted to connect with us on this Kagura mask. We'll look for it. I'll mention you again when we come back to Japanese theater.
Okay. Thanks, Professor DeLuca.
Thank you so much, Brooke. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thanks. Bye.
Great. Yeah. Feel free to use the phone and call us. It's always interesting, especially when we have faces like this poor guy to talk about here. but yes, all of this aspect of ritual is very, very unique. There's a great deal of significance in a ritual in terms of making the individual feel part of the larger community. There's a wonderful book. This is Sedge, who is an Eastern European author, and his Masks of Black Africa was a very instrumental book on many other writers as well. This is just one section of what he says about the connection between the individual and the community. The most significant result of a mythologically framed constitution asserting unalterable truth, a system of supreme ethical values and norms, was that it promulgated spiritual and social coherence. And that's a wonderful phrase that is at the heart of what ritual is for. It's to create social coherence, to bring everyone together, basically. Myths were solidifying, stabilizing agents, and last but not least, they resolved the individual's existential dilemma. We shall see that this produced a sense of oneness with nature. The African participating in a ritual sensed this unity more acutely when he witnessed the acting out by masked dancers of the myth about his tribe's past. He was not an observer. He became engulfed and absorbed. He experienced being part of the mythical past. He was able to identify himself with that which was presented to him as permanent and sacred reality. Because of this identification, he was able to step out of his ordinary, ego-centered daily life. His individual life was depersonalized, elevated. He was able to enter into the realm of the consecrated, into a sublime, spiritual, otherworldly existence. And that's exactly what he's referring to about the individual's existential dilemma. Are we really alone? And that's a lot of what mask exercises and rituals and myths that derive from them contribute to a society. It makes you feel that you are part of something bigger than just yourself. So there's a great psychological impact that happens because of this masking. In fact, interesting that one of our students commented on this. Sean Foster wrote about how important it is in terms of the community participation in a ritual. Sean said, "I found the first chapter intriguing as it delves into the origins and past uses of masks. Africans, Europeans, Asians, and Native Americans all utilized masks in an effort to portray something greater than the actual face or human that wears it. While these held spiritual implications for the most part, outside of theatrical purposes in the European region, the mask provided a sense of community power." And that's very at the heart of what Sedge is writing about, Sean. The idea that the mask provided a sense of community power. It's not just an individual power. So when we look at an individual mask, we think we're seeing a particular face, but in a strange way, Like Marsh was saying about how we're looking at tribal behavior, a mask represents more than one person. It represents, to some extent, an archetype, so that that face maybe looks like the father, or it maybe looks like the young lover. And I'm going through actual roles in theatrical companies that were cast according to these types. We call them stereotypes. But to some extent, in masking cultures, they were archetypal figures that people could easily recognize. So very interesting comments about community participation. Also, as Sedge was just referring to, the importance of myth is significant in all of this. Obviously, a myth is when a pre-scientific culture is trying to explain natural phenomenon without knowing scientifically, based on observations of the movement of the Earth or it's being tilted on the axis, how seasons change or how there's more sun in the warmer months than there are in the in the winter months. So mythologies are answers to basically the chaos that we see around us and to try to put some order in there. As John Nunley said in his wonderful book, Masks, Faces of Culture, rituals provide fixed markers against the lack of fixation, that they kind of hold us together as a community. The unchanging face of the mask provides a further sense of permanence during unsettling times of transition. The transformation of man to mask dancer symbolizes the states of transformation people experience in life cycles. And also another famous writer that you're probably familiar with is Joseph Campbell. Joseph Campbell devoted a lot of his work to myth. And it's interesting that Bill Moyers interviewed him, and Moyers said, I came to understand from reading your books that what human beings have in common is revealed in myths, that myths are the thing that connect us as a community. Myths are stories of our search through the ages of truth for meaning, for significance. We all need to tell our story and to understand our story. We all need to understand death and to cope with death. And we all need help in our passages from birth to life and then to death. We need for life to signify, to touch the eternal, to understand the mysterious, to find out who we are. Wonderful expression of the importance of myths. And it goes on, people say that we're all seeking, that what we're seeking is the meaning of life. I don't think that's what we're actually seeking. I think that what we're seeking is an experience of being alive, so that our life experience on the purely physical plane will have resonances within our innermost being and reality, so that we actually feel the rapture of being alive. That's what it's all finally about, and that's what these clues help us to find within ourselves, the feeling of being alive. That's a wonderful quintessential Joseph Campbell. So yes, ritual and myth factor into masking in a very significant way. And I also want to introduce the concept of sympathetic magic, which is, I had a nice comment here by Kevin Yanagi on myths, which I want to include. What I found most interesting is the role of myths in their associated masks in unconnected civilizations around the world in the years prior to scientific advancement. Just like people today, our ancestors sought ways to understand, predict, and even control their environments. Much of this came in the form of connecting with their spiritual selves, as it was their primary way of understanding the natural events around them, that which they could not explain scientifically. It's not difficult to see how their myths converted over time to rituals, which evolved into stricter practices and eventually into religions. Very good, Kevin. That's a wonderful way of looking at it. And, you know, a lot of this does come together on looking at sympathetic magic, the idea that these cultures are attempting, as the Cambridge anthropologist said, to try to get some help from above, that these rituals were a way of imploring the ancestors to come back and help us and give us some kind of sympathetic magic. Or as one of my students in a class a couple years ago said, some kind of help, to have some kind of help. And that is a good definition of sympathetic magic. We also wanted to look at the difference between burial masks and death masks, but I think you understand that death masks clearly are for the living to keep, but the burial masks, and we'll see next week when we go to King Tut, go down there with the deceased. I want to finish, though, on a wonderful comment that Krista Graham made, and if I can read this to you, I think it'll help finish our first class. Krista said that masks are props used as vehicles to expression. Masks provide a way for the wearer to be cloaked and therefore is no longer subject to the mere human standards of politeness and being politically correct. There's a sense of belonging as well as anonymity created by the mask that allows for the communication or acting out of one's agenda that may not be perceived as polite or appropriate in regular life. Carl Jung and Oscar Wilde spoke of the psychological aspects of the mask, and while it is a unifying gesture that all of mankind has independently created these masks, it also serves as a way to find the underlying part of our identities that we as humankind often suppress. Knowing not only what you are on the surface, but what is that is being repressed allows people to become individualized form of their person. The mask is the vehicle to let out the true you. I love that, Krista. That's a great way to identify really what's at the heart of our course here, that the mask is the vehicle to let out the true you, that it is a covering, but at the same time, it allows us to uncover. And a number of you, like Billy Song said, masks can help us discover new parts of ourselves. So very good observations by all the students on the discussion board. But we're going to have to break here. And I hope I'll get more of you to join in, like Cassandra and Wendy and Brooke did today, next Thursday when we cover African masks. So thank you for joining in to Power of Masks tonight.